In this video, I'd like to discuss the concepts of balance of linear and angular momentum at a global scale. So global balance of linear and angular momentum. So these are laws that you can discern in the laboratory by measuring linear and angular momentum balance and its time rates of change on finite quantities of material. So our setup will be the standard setup where we will have a body B, and we'll look at a part of that body P, and after deformation by the deformation map chi, the body will take the shape BT, and the part will now have the shape PT. And we'll start off by defining linear momentum. So the linear momentum of our part is going to be the mass times the velocity. So in this case, rho dv would constitute a infinitesimal mass. I multiply it by the velocity, that will give me the momentum. And if I integrate over the part, that will then give me the linear momentum of that part. So this is the linear momentum of PT. The angular momentum can be similarly defined. It's simply the moment of the linear momentum. So it will be r cross rho u dot dv integrated over the part P. And we'll use the symbol h to denote angular momentum. And r just simply refers to the position vector to the reference point about which I'm going to compute moments. So whenever you compute moments, you have to pick a reference point. So we'll just pick the origin. That makes it extra convenient. Okay. And the statements of global balance of linear and angular momentum say that the time rate of change of the linear momentum of the part is equal to the forces that act on the part. And the time rate of change of the angular momentum of the part is equal to the moments that act on the part. So L dot equals F and H dot equals M. Okay. So those are the statements of global linear and angular momentum balance. And those are things that you can measure in the laboratory. And let's continue this and just kind of expand on this a little bit to make it a little bit more specific. So let's first of all consider what types of forces that we can apply to something, and also then correspondingly the moments. So first of all, we can have surface forces acting on the part. So these are sometimes called tractions, and they come as forces per unit area. So you look at the surface area of the part you're looking at, and you have forces per unit area being transmitted to it from the other part of the body. And we'll use the symbol T to denote the traction vector. So it depends on the point you're looking at, and then the orientation of the surface at that point. So it depends on the outward normal to PT at every point X. The other way that we can apply forces to our part PT is through body forces. So these are forces per unit volume. And the classical example of a body force would be a gravitational force. There are other types of forces, electromagnetic forces and things like that, that could also impart body forces to a body. And just to be clear, this body force we're talking about here is the conventional body force, and we don't want to confuse it with the inertial force that's sometimes also called a body force. Okay, so the total force acting on my part PT is going to be the sum of all of these forces. So if I take the force per unit volume here and multiply it by incremental volumes and then add up by integration over the domain PT, I'll get the total body force acting on the part. And I can do the same thing if I take the traction, multiply by the areas, that will give me a force, and then I can add that up through integration over the surface of PT. So, and that just means integrating, doing a surface integral there. So taken together, that gives me the total force on the part of the body that I'm looking at. For the moments, I have something similar, but I simply have to include the cross product of the forces with respect to the lever arm to compute the moment. So that gives me the expression for the total moment acting on PT. Now, if I want to rewrite this, put it all together, the statement of global linear momentum balance is the time rate of change of the linear momentum, which I've written here in its integral form, is equal to the total force acting on the part. And we have a similar expression for the global expression of angular momentum balance, which is the time rate of change of the angular momentum acting on the part is equal to the total moment acting on it. So this is just a restatement of what we had on the prior slide, but written all out in integral form. Okay, so, and note that both these sets of integral equations, they hold for all parts PT subsets of the total body. So we're going to need that later on in when we try and localize these expressions. Now, I want to do one other bit of manipulation here so that I can rewrite these two terms on the left-hand side here. And I want to take this time derivative that's sitting outside the integral sign and move it in. So there's a slight manipulation that's useful to know about. And I'll do this sort of in a generic sense. Suppose I'm taking the time derivative of an integral over a moving domain, so PT is a moving domain, of the density times any function f. And what I can do is I can first do a change of variables so that the domain over which I'm integrating is fixed. So I'll do a change of variables back to the reference coordinates. So I'll have, instead of dv, I'm going to have jdvr, and now my domain of integration is just going to be p, the reference locations occupied by the part that I'm interested in. Okay. Now, because of that, I can take rho and j, I can put them together and write them as the reference density using conservation of mass. And next what I can do is I can move the time derivative inside because the domain of integration is now just a constant. So I can pull the time derivative underneath the integral sign. And the only thing under the integral sign that can possibly depend on time is this function f. So I have the time derivative on f now. I can now start to reverse the steps. So I can split up rho r and write it as rho j again. And now jdv I can write as dv. And this now becomes an integral over the original subset I was looking at, pt, of the spatial density rho times f dot dv. And so this is a classic pattern here. So when you have an integral and you're taking the time derivative of it, and it's an integral over some moving material domain, and there's a density inside the integrand, then you can move the time derivative underneath the integral sign and only apply it to the things in the integrand apart from the spatial density. So if I do that to the linear momentum balance equation, the time derivative will go on the u dot, so I'll get a u double dot. So I get rho u double dot, so density times acceleration integrated over the body, or the part that I'm looking at, is equal to the force acting on it. And I can do the same thing for the angular momentum balance, and I get this expression here now, where I end up with a rho u double dot in the integrand on the left-hand side. Now, to get this integrand here, it's almost as straightforward as I showed up above, but there is a slight trick that, or not really a trick, but an observation you have to make, is that really what I had sitting inside that integrand here before, it was the integral of rho r cross u dot dv with the time derivative on the outside. And so I need to calculate the time derivative here of r cross u dot when I move the time derivative underneath the integral sign. And note that I have this density here, so that allows me just to apply the time derivative to everything else in the integrand other than, well, actually it's this density over here. The time derivative to everything in the integrand other than the density. And so when I take the time derivative of r cross u dot, I'll get an r dot cross u plus an r cross u double dot. Okay, but if I expand out r dot cross u dot, for r it's x minus the reference location, and I put time derivatives on there, so the time derivative of 0 is just 0, and the time derivative of little x is the displacement. So what I'm really looking at in this first term here is u dot cross u dot. So that, but if you dot a vector, or if you take the cross product of a vector with itself, you just get 0. So that term goes away, and the only term that survives is the position vector crossed with the acceleration. So I end up with r cross u double dot, and that's what ended up in this term over here. Okay, so these relationships here are the expressions for global linear and angular momentum balance that we will later use to determine the local expressions for linear and angular momentum balance. But again, it's always important to remember these are supposed to hold for every part P of the body BT that's considered to be an experimental fact.